funky politics.
Funky Politics Education Reform Series is presented by the National Civil Rights Museum, sponsored by Memphis Education Fund and Southwest Tennessee Community College. We'd like to thank our media partner, Chalkbeat Tennessee.
You are listening to Funky Politics, powered by the Kazuki Network. We're visiting this evening with Soledad O'Brien, CEO of Starfish Media Group. That's right, folks. The famous Soledad O'Brien of NBC.
Are you okay,
CNN.
Man?
I'm good.
Starstruck or something? You're stumbling over your words.
Hey, I'm starstruck. Yes, I am.
I've seen this lady.
Let me tell you.
Be the first person that can admit, tell the truth about something.
I will before Congress. I am starstruck. Sorry.
Thank you.
We're talking about Starfish Media Group. Right. And Soledad, this is a new initiative, or I guess it's a brainchild of yours or something that you birthed. And we want to talk about a little bit about Starfish Media Group and its implications on media and journalism around the world and young women.
Well, yeah, one of the things we really wanted to do when I left CNN, I was very interested in starting a production company and doing projects where I could work not just exclusively for one organization, but actually be able to do projects across a number of platforms. So one of the things that we do is we take content, for example, we're working on a project right now around veterans, and with that content, we make sure that it lives in numerous places, PBS NewsHour, of course, when I sold the company at home, and WebMD and a number of other digital platforms so that we get as many viewers for the projects that we're working on. Of course, I'm anchoring a show. It's called Matter of Fact, and with Soledad O'Brien, and it's a Hearst show. So that can be seen around the country. It's about 100 and something affiliates around the country. And then, of course, still a correspondent for HBO Real Sports, which is one of the best touch shows on television, I think.
All right.
So super, super busy, but ultimately trying to get our production company really just working on projects around authentic stories that we care about.
Wow, super, super busy indeed. But one of your areas of influence, I noticed, is education, and that's really something that you seem to be dedicated to.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that, you know, a lot of the documentaries we've done focus on education and really access to education and inequity in education, and I think being able to tell those stories is really critically important.
Wow. Well, from a position standpoint, because there are so many different educational models, everything from college on down to preschool now, and it varies, and the interests vary throughout the country. Some sectors of some other population in some regions don't value pre-K education as much as others. Some focus more on post-secondary, and then there's the whole concept of should education continue to be free or should people have vouchers, and that's a lot of issue that goes on throughout the states. What are some of the key points of education that you find that you want to lend your focus on through Starfish?
You know, I think the most important thing for us is to highlight excellence in education. I'm sort of agnostic when it comes to education. I went to public school. My husband went to boarding school.
Right.
My kids go to an independent school.
So you got it all the way around the board.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and it's sort of, I feel like I like schools that are great schools. And so what we have to figure out is how to get all schools to be great schools so that people can have opportunities to go wherever they want, wherever they feel is a good match for their kid, but where the quality is excellent. I mean, that to me, you know, whether charter or public, it has to be excellent. And there are lots of charter schools that are really not great schools, and I think it's very important that we bring up those charter schools to the quality where they need to be.
You are listening to Funky Politics, powered by the Kazukian Network. We are visiting with this evening Soledad O'Brien, CEO of Starfish Media Group. You know, speaking of charters versus the public, there is a huge argument around the country. Well, if you take dollars out of public schools and put them into charters, then you're taking needed dollars away from inner cities and urban districts. And we find that in the South a lot, and especially in our area of town, that it looks like there's a major fight. And I don't want to call you in on which side you're on, but it seems like that you support just great education, period. But it does, but charter schools do hurt public schools. I mean, it does hurt public education. So how does a public education system get better?
There's no question at all.
Yeah, how does it get better if you're still taking money out of it, though?
Well, I think that you also have to make sure that the education that you're offering is a good education. Otherwise, people wouldn't leave.
Yeah.
Right? If they loved their school, if they felt that their school was offering them everything, then they wouldn't leave. I think the key is to make sure that you're investing in your public schools, that it's a great opportunity for a student, as opposed to being a bad opportunity where they say, listen, maybe I should take my chances at a charter school. Most of the charter schools, most of them certainly that I've covered, are not good schools. I mean, they're poor schools. Wow. Charter schools, I've done stories on some great charter schools, but for the most part, most are not great. And so I think that's problematic. There are lots of public schools as well, as we all know, that are really challenged as well. But the key is you've got to make sure that you're giving, if you're going to give people opportunities, they have to be good opportunities. In Chicago is a really great example where people were leaving the public school.
Right.
And some of those public schools were closed and going to another school that ended up being closed because it was a terrible school. You know what's lost when, I mean, I have a bunch of kids, right? And once you, a child can't lose 2 years in a school with bad education. That's it. That they may never recover from that. So I think often parents feel like there's some great big experiment happening and their kid happens to be the guinea pig in it.
Right.
Doesn't really work like that. That is incredibly unfair. So I actually understand parents who feel like their schools are bad taking the risk of trying to go somewhere because you don't have that much time in a kid. A kid who misses a year or at the end of missing 2 years is so far behind he may not ever recover.
Right. But you've also been part of an educational system because haven't you worked in New Orleans with a charter school or adopted one, or are you working with one now?
Oh, gosh, no. No, I haven't worked specifically with the charter school. We worked with the After School Corporation. I used to be chairman of the board, and the After School Corporation would go in. We don't focus just on charter schools. We focus on any kind of school, their after school program. And so so we were certainly affiliated with their, we helped fund their after school program, and more importantly, helped measure the quality of their after school program. So, yeah, I dropped by a couple of those just to visit. But no, I've never funded a charter school or a public school in any way.
This is Funky Politics, powered by the Kazukia Network. We are visiting this evening with Soledad O'Brien, CEO of Starfish Media Group. You know, and speaking of after school programs, I honestly believe that's one of the places where if public schools were undergirded, that's a very good program, right? After school, especially if we could get parent input to say, look, I'm going to make sure my kid shows up ready to do whatever it is that you ask to do. You know, especially if it's something that's content-based regarding reading and math. That's where we're hurting at in our community right now, Soledad.
Yeah, no, there's no question. Here in New York City, one of the challenges is when you change the schedule, you're changing a lot of other things.
Yes, wow.
You know, so that makes perfect sense. But then, oh, wait a minute, there are buses. There's a contract with a bus company that stipulates the hours. So you can't just go ahead and change the school day without changing your bus schedule. And if you're going to have a bus schedule, that means you have the bus monitors, and then you have bus stops, and who watches, you know, I mean, it just is a complicated system. It's not as easy as just saying, okay, everybody, we're going to stay 2 hours later tomorrow.
Wow.
And I think in these big urban or even small urban environments, it's just a complicated system, much more complicated than the suburban school I grew up in.
Well, you know, this Brad Raymond of the Starfish Foundation, you all have created an opportunity for some young ladies to have some continue their education on some of the post-secondary level. How does that play into your help now in the after-school program, or does it correlate at all? Are these young people that are gotten out of your...
Ultimately, I think it does correlate because it's about investing. I think after-school is about investing and helping students get better, and certainly what we're trying to do with our foundation. The girls are a little bit older, and we pay for students to go to and through college. But listen, I mean, the success in any kind of learning environment is about what you do after hours. You cannot just go to school and expect to be successful. You have to work on those skills after hours, whether it's in homework or after school classes or after school tutoring. So, yeah, I think it's all the extension of the same thing, which is learning can be hard, and if you are having challenges in learning, you really need more opportunities to practice because those are the students for whom learning is even more important.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, one of the things I think, and we've had number of people to talk about education here, and one of the things that we see, it's really not one particular thing. It's a multitude of things, but the ultimate goal is to get an educational system, as you said, quality educational system.
That works.
But also one that is linked up to some type of career placement that allows the students to continue their education and then ultimately find a place to work where they can be, you know, productive members of society.
Yeah, and you know what's interesting? If you ask people in the community who has gone to the high school, most have not, unless they have a kid in the high school. right? Once your kid's out of school, you just don't go. It's sort of silly. And really, I think the businesses locally need to actually not only be investing in the schools, but be in the schools. I mean, you're absolutely right. How do you know if you're teaching the right things when the people around you who are hiring are saying, you know what we really need? We need kids who can think on their own two feet. We need kids who are not just going to take the answers, but are going to work collaboratively in a team to come up with answers. Those kinds of things could really inform a high school, you know, about what how to change strategy so that the kid who comes through the process is much more valued to employees. They don't have to train them over again. And often you hear from employers, remnant employers, not employees, employers, you know, you hear them say, like, your training is, you're teaching people for the kind of job we haven't done here in 20 years.
Right. Yeah, that's right.
But don't we need a system, though, that's actually where business is not just the place where you go afterwards. It's actually in the school, business, agriculture, whatever it is that a child can do in that locale. Everyone needs to be at the table from that planning stage, though, at the beginning. It doesn't need to be something that, you know, everyone is just sort of making sure that their part is good, and when this child gets there, they can educate them. Doesn't this need to be a comprehensive planning effort, particularly in the in cities where you have a number of kids?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. But I think we have to kind of rethink high school education for sure, because I have a friend who was hiring at Google, and he was sort of like, you know, wouldn't the most valuable thing that I could give you is to tell you what Google wants in students? He's like, I'll get hit up all the time to give money. But you know what's more valuable than money I could give, than a check I could write? I could go back and say, listen, this is really what you should be teaching kids, because this is who Google hires.
Right, right.
You know, that would be worth gajillions of dollars. That kind of insight would be very, very valuable.
And, you
know, and so I think, you know, I think schools would appreciate that kind of insight, and often they don't get it.
And you know, I agree with you completely. You know, the Steve Jobs, all of these guys out there, Tim Cooks, the Soledad O'Briens. I mean, if we could wrap our hands around them in some of these urban, these large urban districts, and basically come in just talk and say, look, you would be a perfect person to say, look, young lady or young man, this is how you get into broadcasting. This is how it works in journalism. This is
what
you're
doing. Honestly, I'm going to disagree.
You
know what you do?
What is that?
You hand that kid a camera and say, go tell a story.
Right. Wow.
You don't need me to inspire you and cheerlead you. That lasts a day. If it goes well, it's like, I'm psyched. And then it's like, I don't know what to do with that.
Right.
You wanted to be in broadcasting, then go report. Go do have a class on broadcasting. Have send everybody out with their iPhone, which is TV quality. Have an easy edit program. And then everybody can go every day and turn out a 2-minute story on something that's happening in their life.
And they don't have to wait until
they're 4 years
of college to finally go and get a job, you know, when you've got all kinds of independent media out here where people can start working today.
And I also think that the way things work today, it's not a lecture at the front of the classroom inspiring you if they're a good lecture or boring the hell out of you if it's a bad lecture.
Yeah.
It's saying, here's a project, it needs a solution. Go find a solution. What do you think? Well, how do we get to a solution? Because that's what the real world is, right? Here's a problem.
Yeah.
We're not exactly sure how to get to the answer. Let's work in teams to get to the answer. It's not me lecturing you. I think that is a real thing that schools need to move off.
Well, taking that back sort of to where we are right now, with this administration that's coming in, and I don't even want to pretend to fabricate a position that they have on education because I'm not really clear on what it is. But where do we see education going? Particularly for, you know, black students, Latino students, other, you know, historically labeled as minority students. Where do we see that going in the near future, and what are some things that we need to do to make sure that we continue the efforts?
I don't know. That's a really good question. I don't know that we have enough data points, enough information on this new administration to really be able to tell you that credibly.
But if you think conservative, you think a lot of times, you know, voucher programs, you know, sort of the marginalizing of public education. Yeah. You think about more private-based and charter school systems and the like. So, and really not necessarily a primary focus on funding education to the same extent that it's been traditionally funded. So with that coming into play, if that were going to be a case, and with us mostly depending on being the ones that depend on public education, Where do we go? Where do you think we go?
I don't know. I mean, there's nothing. Those things have all been raised, but I think there's been a million things that have been raised.
Yeah, sure.
And then
sure.
undercut. So, yeah. I mean, who truly knows until there's an appointment, and that appointment now has an agenda,
yeah.
and that agenda is something that actually is going to be seen through. All I know is that we've got some random things that have been said in random campaign stuff.
Yeah.
I have no idea.
Well, I got one question here for you. Soledad O'Brien, where are you headed to? What's on the horizon for the Soledad O'Brien brand out there? Because I mean, you're still very hot out there. People, you're well known. Folks have got you in town, out of town all the time. Where are you going now? What's next? What's next on the agenda?
I think at the end of the day, what I like to do, and I put a lot of thought into this after our election results came in, we obviously tell stories, and we're going to continue to tell stories, focusing on those things that are working. I think often we tell stories about or have people yell at each other on the air about the things that are not working. But I think we can do more about what is working, what stories are working in some capacity. So that's definitely what we're going to try to be doing more of.
And make sure that people are held accountable.
That's right.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You are listening to Funky Politics, powered by the Kazukia Network. And we're visiting this evening with Soledad O'Brien, CEO of Starfish Media Group and media mogul of the world.
This is DC and Doc Ward talking to you about a great opportunity available for you at Southwest Tennessee Community College.
You can get a business degree. You can open doors to a wide range of opportunities. Engineering and information technicians are in demand to help power manufacturing and logistics. And paralegal studies, man, those majors are in big demand right now. Register now for spring classes starting January 17th. Call 901-333-4399. A wide range of programs for the most in-demand careers are just another reason. Southwest Tennessee Community College is your best choice.
In Memphis, there are 116,000 very important young minds. 20,000 of them attend schools in the bottom 5%.
The Memphis Education Fund partners with committed organizations to give these students access to an equitable education.
Their partners work to operate quality schools, recruit, retain, and develop effective teachers and leaders, ensure community voice, and support the needs of the whole child in Shelby County's priority schools.
This is the story of a great people, of hopes and dreams, of challenge and change. It's an American story. The story and struggle that started many centuries ago lives today in the halls and on the walls of the renovated National Civil Rights Museum. Enter the Supreme Court Halls of Justice, sit with Rosa Parks on the Montgomery bus, hear Mahalia Jackson sing at the March on Washington. Plan now to visit the National Civil Rights Museum at the Lorraine Motel in Memphis, Tennessee. For more information, log on to civilrightsmuseum.org.